All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you again just for another night, another opportunity to be here in your house to better understand your word. Give us a mind to really absorb the things that we need to learn tonight, that we can really grasp the beauty and the magnificence and the miracle of your word and how you have used the primitive tool of human language to express your eternal and inexpressible word. So just give us the gift of understanding tonight as we dive deep into some of these issues. And we pray for your spirit to be upon us and to be in us, that he would fill and empower us, and that you would quicken our bodies, Lord. Keep us alert. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so tonight we are going to get a little technical. That's okay. This will be the one sort of technical class. And I'm going to do my best to try to get through. We've got a lot of material to sort of go through. And as far as the process that we're going through, this is step two, we call pulling it into focus, right? Observation. We are still in the what does it say mode. Okay, we're not dealing with what does it mean yet. And you know, and I apologize, last week at the end of the class, we sort of started getting into a lot of, well, what does it really mean? What does it mean? And we were almost getting into a little bit of a debate of some things and where it was going with that and what it meant. And really, we haven't even left that station yet. We're still in the what does it say. So as we go through tonight, I'm going to talk a little bit about original languages, and then we're going to go through the verse. And we're going to look at the words in the verse, and we're going to talk about what those words how we translate those words. What those words actually say. And now, without getting too deep into theology, into doctrine, into trying to understand what it means, we're just going to look at how we can find out what it's actually saying. So, again, what we're talking about tonight is language, and we talked a little bit about this, I think, in the first or second class, is just how this is something that is unique to man. While we know that other creatures on earth communicate with one another in primitive fashion, man is the only living thing on earth that has any kind of an organized language, something that can be taught, something that can be explained. If, you know, most languages on earth have alphabets. Some don't. Chinese technically does not have an alphabet, but there is still a system. There is a universal understanding among languages, even if it's different from language to language. You know, I mean, if we bring somebody in here from England who has never been to America in his life, he's never even met an American, we can pretty much understand everything that he said. You know, unless he's like deep in Scotland, that throat gets a little tough sometimes, but it's the same language. There is a universal aspect to it, that there are rules, and there's a procedure, and there's a way of understanding it. You know, and we all grew up with it, with our teachers and our parents correcting our pronunciation of certain words. Correct, don't say ain't. Remember, don't say ain't, or your mother will faint, you know, all that kind of stuff. Don't use that phrase, blah, 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 blah. You're saying that wrong. There's a way to say it. You know, nowadays it's getting a little, those lines are getting very blurry. There's a lot of sort of postmodernism going on, even in the English language. But for the most part, there are rules, there are procedures you follow. The same is true for the languages that were used in writing the Bible. Okay? what I would encourage us to do is not, you know, we use language, I mean, I'm up here using words, and you guys are for the most part understanding what I'm saying. We use language so effortlessly that we become familiar with. Become familiar with the, you know, sort of the science behind it. And even the use of proper grammar and saying things in the right way. An example in the Bible that I like to use is in Ephesians 4, verse 11, when it talks about he gave gifts. Right? And let's see if we can turn there. An English example I can give is like, are we going to eat, Grandma? Or are we going to eat, Grandma? Right? Two very different things. And I just changed the inflection in my voice. I didn't even use grammar. I just changed the inflection in my voice. But an example in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Okay? Now, in some translations of the Bible, there is a comma between saints and for. So that it says, he gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Now, what does that sound like? That sounds like the equipping of the saints, the work of the ministry, and the edifying of the body of Christ. That's a list of things that those guys do. Right? That's not what it is in the original language. The original language, the only thing those guys do is it says this. And he gave some to be apostles, and some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Whole different meaning, isn't it? The job of these guys, this gift that God is giving, is for the equipping of the saints, so the saints can do the work of the ministry for the edifying of the body of Christ. Just one comma changes the whole connotation of the sentence. And that's how crucial it is to really understand, you know, we're not going to understand all of Greek and Hebrew grammar here tonight. I don't even understand all of it. Studied Greek pretty well. I understand most of the grammar. Hebrew, I know very little about. We're going to talk a little bit about Hebrew. But it's enough to just know that it's important, to do your best to try to get to the bottom of it. And there are tools out there that help us to sort of make that transition so that we understand what the English equivalent of that grammatical principle is. So the important thing now to remember as we get into these languages is that this is not English. These are not Western languages. These are Eastern languages. They're ancient languages. They are, you know, very, in the case of Hebrew, in some sense, a very primitive language. Okay, very uncomplicated in a certain fashion. They thought differently than we did. They didn't think with a Western mind. They also thought with an ancient mind. They didn't. They just had a different thought process. We're going to find out with the Hebrew and Greek. It's a much more pictorial language than we have today. We're much more analytical and sort of scientific about our language. The problem is we don't read it in those languages. We read it in our language. So we have a tendency to hear God's voice with a Western accent, if you will, you know. But it is very important and very helpful for us to sort of get into that Eastern mind, that ancient mind, remembering that principle of verbal plenary, that the Bible is inspired. It is the Word of God down to the very word. That every word is the word that God chose. And it's the word in the original language, not in any other translation. And And this is why what we do, what we're going to do here tonight, is called exegesis. Exegesis means to lead out. It's you're trying to draw out the things that are in there that are sort of hidden. We're unpacking it and pulling it out. First language we're going to look at is Greek, because it's, believe it or not, probably even as complex as it is, it's a little easier for us to understand because it's more similar to English than Hebrew is. So we'll start with the Greek, and I was just having a conversation before class started about what Greek is this? Is it a special Greek? Is it some high holy Greek? Odyssey, the Iliad, all those great Greek works that were written in what's called classical Greek. That is a high academic Greek. Okay, very proper, sort of like the King's English. You know, it's a very, very high Greek. Koine Greek, it may sound, look a little familiar to, you know, we call our cafe the Koinonia Cafe, right? Koinonia is the Greek word for fellowship. Or common. Koine means common. It's the common Greek. It's the everyday Greek. It's the Bronx English. It's the Greek on the street. That's what it is. They used to think it was a high holy type of Greek, and then they found it as graffiti. And they realized, no, this was street Greek. You know, and that says something, because this is the language of the people. Just like, you know, when Jerome translated the Bible into Latin, he called it the Vulgate. Because at the time, nobody was speaking Greek, and he wanted people to be able to read the Bible. There weren't enough people that spoke Greek anymore. Latin was the language of the day, and he wanted the people. And that word Vulgate means people in Latin. So the Vulgate was a Bible so the people could read, and that's what the Koine Greek is. That being said, even though it was common, Greek is still a very, very specific and technical language. In that day, Greek was the what we call the lingua franca, which is it was the common language. It was everybody spoke Greek, even if they spoke something else, even if their native tongue was Aramaic or Latin or Arabic or whatever, they also spoke Greek, because the philosophy of the Greeks, philosophy of Alexander the Great was he conquered a land, and when he conquered that land, he said, now you have to become Greek. You dress Greek, you look Greek, you know, people had to shave, they would keep their hair more closely cropped than some other cultures might. They would adopt a Greek look, and they would also adopt the Greek language. They had to. That was part of the process of what was called the Hellenization of the world. Alexander wanted the whole world to be Greek. The Romans didn't care. Romans conquered a land and said, look, speak what you want, act like you want, worship who you want, we don't really care, just behave yourself. Don't cause trouble. Don't stir things up. We don't care what you believe. We don't care what you look like. We're not going to change your language. Just behave yourself. The Greeks were very different. The Greek system. They immersed everybody in Greek culture and in Greek the Greek language. So as we were just talking before class, I liked the phrase in the fullness of time, Christ came, and that speaks of a lot of things, and one of the things I believe it speaks of is the timing of the Greek language. Greek language was at its pinnacle at about the first century AD. That was at its widest influence across the known world. It was right in the first century, and it was at the height of its understanding as well. And at that time, God began to write the New Testament in that language and prepared the Greek language for the writing, specifically for the writing of the Bible. You know, in the Old Testament in Isaiah, God calls Nebuchadnezzar his servant. That he will use his servant Nebuchadnezzar to conquer the Jews of that day and bring them into exile. You know, we often think of these people like Nebuchadnezzar, like Alexander the Great, as being the enemy. Oh, they're not godly people. No, they're not, but they're still God's servant. God uses them for his purposes, because God is sovereign. So God used Alexander the Great to spread the Greek language so that it was at its pinnacle at the time when the New Testament was to be written. It's a very technical language, but you don't have to be a Greek scholar. You really don't. You don't have to get real, you don't have to be studying books and become fluent in Greek and all that kind of stuff. The only thing that you really have to understand is that it is an Eastern language. It's a different way of looking at things. Okay? Verbs, for example. We look at verbs, and for the most part, we say past, present, future. Now, we've got a few things in there. We've got past perfect, true perfect, and we've got a few little adjustments in there that we use. But for the most part, we think of verbs in the sense of when did it happen? When did it happen? We're reading something, we want to know when did it happen. The Greeks, they had that, but it was secondary. When it happened was secondary to how it happened. Okay? The Greeks look at what kind of action was it? Was it a completed action? Or did it happen and then it was done? Or did it go on for a period of time and then it was done? Or did it go on for a period of time and it's still going on? And they looked at what's called the aspect of a language, more so than the time aspect of it. Three things to know in the Greek language. Okay? Any verb, and the verbs, if you study a language, the verbs are king. Verbs are everything. Nouns are easy, for the most part. You know, nouns are it's just a matter of knowing the vocabulary. You know, Greek and Latin, you gotta know a little bit more than that, but it's not that difficult. The verbs are everything. So we're gonna look at verbs primarily tonight. Okay? And just briefly. The three things you look for in a verb, in a Greek verb, is tense, mood, and voice. Okay? Tense is what kind of action was it? Mood is what's the attitude of the action? Okay? And the voice is what is the relation of the action to the person? Okay? Let's just do tense first. Okay? Tense. Let me see. I kind of jumped through something, didn't I? Come on, look up. Yeah. Hello. Hey, Tony, you want to just
over here?
What's that?
It's time here.
Just tap the pad there for a second. Just tap the pad. Tony, can you go take a look at
space bar?
Give me that next slide.
Hey, Pastor.
Yeah. Sure.
Just a quick question before you continue. Are we to assume then that Greek came at its highest level of spreading around the 2nd century AD then?
Around the 1st century AD was at its widest usage. You know, and this is why what's great is it was the combination of the Greek being at its pinnacle. And then Rome being in charge, though, which Rome is famous for the Roman roads, the highways. They built roads everywhere they went. So now it became easy to get anywhere in the world, because now there were roads leading to everywhere. You know, so it was, God had prepared it for for the writing and the dissemination of the New Testament. Because now we had this language that everybody understood, and we had a way of getting it out to everyone. Oh, there we go. That's just an example of Greek. Just wanted you guys to see. You have the alphabet in front of you. It's you know, obviously it's a different alphabet. It's a very different looking language. It reads like ours. It starts on the left and it goes this way. Some of these little marks and things, and punctuation things, are what's called breathe marks. So that O is actually whole. Okay, it's just the word the. You know, and this is actually the Lord's Prayer. That's Father, that's our. This is who is in heaven. So this is just the Lord's Prayer here, just to give you an idea of what Greek looks like. Okay, so we have tense. We have present tense, which is like our present tense. Okay, current, continuous, durative. No reference to beginning, though. Okay, I study Greek. I say, I study Greek. That doesn't give you a lot of information other than I'm doing it right now. You don't know when I started. Or I can say, I am studying Greek. That sort of gives a little bit more of a continuous aspect to it. But either one is good for the present. Present is pretty much like our present. It's just an ongoing action going on at the moment. Very undefined as to where the perfect is a completed action. It's something that was going on and then stopped, or it could have been something that just happened and stopped, but it has sort of the connotation that we look back on it because now we are, so if I say, I have studied Greek, okay, it's something that I did in the past. I'm not doing it anymore. I have studied Greek. But the connotation of it is, it's something that I now have. It's something that it now exists in me, if you will. I have done this. So now I am presently in a position of having done that. So it sort of is talking about something that went on in the past. It ended. But you can look back on it, and you are now, it has ongoing results in the present. Imperfect is something that was going on in the past, it stopped in the past, and that's it. I was studying Greek. So if I say, I was studying Greek, what you hear in your head is, okay, he was doing it for a time, but he's not doing it anymore. And not just, he did it in a moment. I was studying Greek. It sounds like, okay, he was doing it for an extended period of time. You know, with the perfect, there's not necessarily that indication that it necessarily went on for a period of time. It could have been something that just happened in a moment, okay? Future is very much like our future, okay? I will study Greek. It's something that is going to happen. It could be something that is going to happen in a moment in the future. It could be something that is going to happen over a period of time. I am going to study Greek. And that makes it sound like it's something that's going to happen over a period of time. So it could be either. The one that is very unusual is this aorist tense. Aorist means undefined, no definition. There is no English equivalent to it. We do our best to translate it as a simple past tense. I studied Greek. It's the best way we can do it because it's something that happened in a moment in time that we really don't know anything else about. We don't know if it went on for a period of time. We don't know if it was going on and ended. We don't know if it's still going on. There's no definition to it whatsoever. It's the emphasis is on it happened, period. So when we see the aorist tense, it just means something that again, getting out of our Western mind and trying to think about when it happened and all that kind of stuff, doesn't matter about that. It just, the emphasis is on it happened, it's done with, that's it. It's just the emphasis on the fact that it happened. Not when it happened, not how it happened, or anything like that. Okay? voice. Okay, voice, active, passive, and middle. Okay? Active is what we use most of the time. The subject performs the action, I give. Passive is the subject receives the action, I was given. Okay? I'm the subject, but I am passive in this sentence. I'm passive. I'm not doing anything, it's happening to me. Okay, the middle, now the Greek has what's called a middle. We have this, we have active and passive, but the Greek has what's called a middle voice, which the subject performs and receives the action. The best example we can give in English is, I gave myself. But you'll see places in the Greek where it seems to be translated as a simple passive, but there's actually, you have a participation in it, but you're also receiving the action. Okay, lastly is mood. Indicative mood, and we talked a little bit about this. Indicative mood is what is. It is just the mood of what is a fact. Okay? Imperative is when it is what we should do. It's a command. And the subjunctive means what could be, what should be, what might be. It's not definitely that it is. It may be in the future. Or could be an attitude of what, you know, what should be.
Isn't the subjunctive usually tied to a conditional?
Yes. The subjunctive and the conditional are very closely related. Except, again, like I said, with the conditional, you know, the condition, we talked about the four conditionals. If and it is, if and it isn't, if and it may or may not be, and if, and it probably would be. And that was more like the subjunctive, but it is tied to the conditional, particularly the third and fourth class condition. It's the mood of the verb is not affirmative. It's just something that could be, not necessarily something that will be. Because something that will be, you know, it could be a future indicative. This will happen. I will study Greek. That's a fact. Okay? I might study Greek. That's a subjunctive. Okay? You have this with you. Prepositions are crucial. That's why I wanted you to have a copy of this to look at some of the points of the preposition. We're going to talk about at least one of them, this D and through today. We've heard Pastor Bill talk about the Holy Spirit being para, beside, en, in, and then epi, upon. Okay, and it's just a nice diagram so we can kind of get an idea when we see these things. And what you'll see often is, in the Greek, is these compound words, okay? Episkopos, or episkopos, okay? Epi, upon, or over. It can mean like, you know, not Hooper over, but it's still on top of, if you will, okay? Skopos is to see, or to view. So this is an overseer. Was through the years was later translated as bishop, episkopos, or episkopos, eventually was transliterated into bishop, okay? Another word that we know well is apocalypso, right? Apocalypse. Apo. What is it? What's apo up here? From. Right? Calypso means to cover. So this is to take the cover away from, or to unveil, or to reveal, which is why it's translated as revelation. Okay, it's a revealing, apocalypto, to take the cover away from. So you see, that's why I want you to see this, because you'll see, when you see a Greek word, look for these. Look for these prepositions in the front of them. Kata is another one that is used a lot. And sometimes it means down, but it's sort of an intensive. It'll take a verb and it makes it more intense if you put kata in front of it, you know? And so when you see a Greek word, look for, you know, hupo, you get that all the time, you know? Hupo is under. The word submit in the Greek, in the English language, in the Greek is hupotasso, to stand under, to, you know, to, yeah, to stand under. Patience, hupomeno. Hupomeno means to remain under. And it's translated as long-suffering or patience, okay? So it just, it gives you a real understanding when you start seeing how these prepositions play a role in the Greek language.
I know when Pastor Bill was talking about the fruits, and one of the fruits was long-suffering, does that really mean patience, or does that
mean? That's what.
Because I thought it meant just being able to suffer for a long time.
Well, this is where we run into problems with translation, because the word suffer, in the modern language, in modern English, the word suffer means to suffer, to go through torment, to go through trial. The word suffer in Old English means to allow. Jesus said, suffer the children to come unto me. Allow the children to come to me. So if we say long suffering means to allow something for a long time. To remain under, you know, hupomeno, to abide under, to be patient, to allow it for a long period of time. And that's, you know, again, that's where we run into problems with that's why I have issues with the New King James. Not that it's a bad translation, but, you know, it's 1611. I mean, that was, you know, 500 years ago, over 500 years ago. And languages change. And, you know, some of it's been updated, but some of it hasn't been. And that's always my example. That word suffer is, it doesn't mean what it means today.
Well,
that's why it confuses, because people say,
long
suffering means, and that's not what it means. It just means patience, you know. But be careful, because remember, the Bible says tribulation works patience. So, people say, God, give me patience. Okay, but understand, patience doesn't just land on you. Patience has to be worked in you. That's tribulation works patience. But that's all that word means. So, now we move on to Hebrew, quickly. That's just a quick primer on Greek. You know, go through some of this stuff and look at it for yourself. This is what Greek looks like. I mean, Hebrew looks like. It reads from right to left, okay? And it's just incredibly complex looking. Doesn't look like anything we have. And it's more closely related to Chinese. If you look at your Hebrew, if you look at your, you know, it's got the ancient, the ox head was the picture that this letter, okay, which is today it's called Aleph, but then it was L. Changed from an ox head, and you can see how it sort of evolved into a different shape, but the idea was the same thing. Chinese is very similar. The Chinese character was supposed to look, originally looked like the thing that it was. I remember my friend was studying Chinese, and the word for father originally came from a figure that looked like a stick figure with a whip in his hand, because he was the disciplinarian. And so that was the word for father, and then that stick figure of a man with a whip in his hand sort of evolved and turned into something that doesn't quite look like that anymore, but Hebrew is very similar. It's a very pictorial language. And each of these letters, it's very important that each of these letters does stand for something. You know, because it looked like something, and there's meaning even behind the letters. As you look through what you have, what's something you notice about Hebrew that is very different from English? Besides the way it looks, besides the fact that it goes the other way, look at the letters. Is there something missing?
Vowels.
Vowels. Even Aleph is silent. Is that fairly correct there, Bob?
What?
There's no vowels, right? It's all primarily consonants. And that's why you see now, let me ask Bob this. Maybe you don't know if that's okay. I don't mean to put you on the spot. The little stuff underneath, is that sort of the vowel sounds?
That was added later.
Right, it was added later, but is that what that's supposed to be?
They're vowels.
Yeah, because there was not originally vowels, but in order to read it in the Western mindset, we're like, hey, we gotta have sounds in here. So they came later and they added these little things under here for the to be vowels. Now, if you guys have wondered about when Jesus said every jot and tittle, okay. I don't know if you can see, but on this, on Bet here, on Bet, see that little point?
It's the yod, the yod.
What's that?
The yod.
Okay, yod.
Yod, 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 yod.
That little, that
second
little
from the bottom.
Tip there, okay? That's a jot. That little point, the very top of it, that's a jot. Any little flare, like on this one here, see that little flare at the top? That's a jot. And in here, a tittle would be like, see that little thing up there, that little extra thing up there, almost like punctuation marks. Okay? So when Jesus said not a jot or a tittle will fall, I mean, he's talking about not just the words of the letters, but the flare on the end of the letter and the little dot above it. Hebrew's a very different language. It's a Semitic language. It's not an isolated language. I mean, it was a very common, and in that area, there was sort of a common ancestor to the language. The Semitic language, the language of Shem, right? The son of Noah. And that's why even today, there are similarities in Arabic and Hebrew, okay? In Hebrew, peace is shalom. In Arabic, it's salem. In Hebrew, God is El or Eloi or Elohim. In Arabic, it's Allah. So it's certainly gone along, you know, thousands and thousands of years, and they've gone their separate ways, but it's not an isolated language. It's not some ancient lost language. I mean, as you can see, Bob studied it as a child. It's a more modern version of it, but it's still basically the same language. but it is an ancient language, and it's very different, not just in its structure, but in its attitude. It's a different way of looking at action completely. There's really no tenses whatsoever. There's no regard almost entirely for past, present, future. It's all in aspect, okay? Is it, generally speaking, is it perfect or is it imperfect? Is it a completed action or an incompleted action, okay? They didn't look at it that way, and that's why you'll see prophecy written in the Old Testament, and it's prophecy, but it looks like it's written in the past tense because it's written as a completed action, and that's the best way we can describe a completed action is by putting it in the past tense, but it's supposed to happen in the future. They just didn't have any regard for past, present, and future. It was more about mood. They had the perfect mood, the imperfect mood. They had, the perfect mood was just a completed action. Imperfect mood was an incompleted action, okay? Something that was in a process. Imperative, like we talked about, in the imperative. It's a command, something that has to be done. Infinitive is another aspect. that is used a lot in Hebrew to intensify things. It's sort of a root of a word. The infinitive of a word is, it expresses the idea of the verb without any sense of anything else about it. So that an example is in Genesis when it says, if you eat this fruit, you shall surely die. What it really says is, in dying, to die. You shall surely die to die. It actually just repeats the word twice. The second one is an infinitive, and that's just how they express sort of the intensity of it, is by saying, you shall surely die to die. And we translate it, you shall surely die, because if we say, you shall surely die to die, that doesn't mean anything to us. Okay, but that's one of the moves is the infinitive. The last one is what's a participle, which is similar to us. It represents an action or condition in an unbroken continuity. I am being changed. Being that sort of that progressive action is a participle. It's an ongoing action. Participle is technically it's when you take a verb and use it like an adjective. And we're going to see it tonight when we look at Ephesians 2, when he says...
Is that like an adverb?
No, it's... Because an adverb describes action. This is describing a thing. So when I say, I am saved, okay? Saved, I'm describing myself. It's a verb. Saved is a verb, but I'm using it in a way to describe myself. So it's a participle. Okay. Or if we say things like, sometimes it can be used because there's no subject to it. Playing the piano is fun. That's a participle. Playing the piano. Okay, it's a descriptive word. Using a verb is sort of a descriptive thing. Okay. Quickly, the other thing with Hebrew is what are called Hebrew stems, so there's certain types of verbs.
Going back over here, does this mean that in the ancient Hebrew that there were just words, there wasn't, so each of these symbols would be a word?
No, it was still an alphabet, but each of these letters represented something, whether the letter came from the word or the word came from the letter, it might have been something that, it looks like it, they look, sun on the horizon, that looks like a sun on the horizon maybe, if this is sort of a horizon with the sun rising or whatever, maybe they even looked at it and thought that it looked like that thing. I don't know if Bob has any insight on that.
In Hebrew, every word's got three key letters, which is funny, three.
Mm-hmm.
Three letters. And out of those three letters, any combination of three letters, they can make a million words. Verbs,
yeah.
Nouns. That's the first thing they teach you.
Well, four and they have
roots. You have three-letter roots.
Right, and they have, and there are, and you might be talking about the thing I'm talking about, which is stems. Which is this, there's actually this four stemmed is what's called the cal, hifil, the nifil, and the pl. I may not be pronouncing them properly either. These are just types of words, and again, this is how different Hebrew is. The type of stem that is on the word, kind of like what Bob is talking about, that there are certain words that have a similar stem because they have a similar type of meaning. I mean, our English language is not like that at all. We don't have words that, because of their meaning, maybe sort of similar, that they have the same look to them. Tony?
On Blue Letter Bible, it includes those in part of parsing the verbs. How does that tie in with the verb?
Well, because these are the verbs. These are the four verb stems. There's actually seven. But the other three are combinations of the ones that are here. Okay? Cal is the most frequently used one. It is it expresses just simple or casual action. Most verbs are cal verbs. Okay, it's just simple action. If it's a causative action, if the verb is something that was being caused to happen, the type of verb itself is something that is caused, then it's in the hifil. Okay? If it's something that is a passive type of verb, it's in the nifil. And the PL verbs are words that are intense verbs, like something like break. The word to break, it sort of has an intensive attitude toward it, so that would have a PL stem. Again, this is not stuff you necessarily have to memorize, but just to understand, it's a very different language, and it is a very pictorial language. You know, the sentence structure, you'll see it a lot in the English. They use the word and like a period. And this, and that, and, you know, especially in the, you know, in the creation story. You just see and a lot in the Old Testament. And that's sort of their way of like, okay, I'm done with that thought, now I'm going to the next thought. We use it like, they use an and like a period. Okay, it's the end of a thought and they're moving on to the second thing. It's also very, it's evocative imagery. They often use what's called onomatopoeia, right? Which is a word that sounds like the thing that it is. Okay, an English example, and it's also, and I can't think of what the Hebrew is now, but I know that it's the exact same word, works the same way in Hebrew. The word murmur, okay? It sounds like murmur. When people are murmuring, you get a room full of people murmuring, it sounds like the word murmur. Right? Murmur, 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 murmur. And that's where we even get the word murmur. Well, the word for murmur in the Hebrew is also, it's not murmur, it's another word, but it has a similar sound to that. It's like this little repetitive sounding thing that sounds like a noise of murmuring. So there's a lot of Hebrew words that onomatopoeia. It's a very pictorial language. Okay. They cared more about what picture was being painted than about being technical about the language, you know, the tense and all that kind of stuff. It was less important to them than painting a picture in somebody's mind. Again, because, you know, we have had thousands and thousands of years to sort of tweak and perfect and find all the, you know, sort of the loopholes in the language, you know, that we even see today. We see going on in politics today. Well, I said that, but you know, I didn't mean that. I meant this, because we were talking about that. And when I said I did that, I meant that I did that, not at this time, but I did it, you know, and there's all sort of this weird parsing of language, you know. Depends on what the definition of is. You know, we sort of do all that kind of stuff. Well, with a language that is technically very imprecise, there's a sort of a lot of room for, you know, looking at things in different ways. And they were okay with that, because it was about sort of the experience of the language more than being technical about it. But that's what God wanted for the Old Testament. God was trying to get across a big picture, whereas in the New Testament, he's getting into more details. First Greg.
Now, with the Hebrew, you say it was a pictorial language, right? Now, is that because, like, the ancient Hebrew was more of a spoken language?
Well, it was written too. It was a written language.
Yeah, but not everybody could read, right?
Yeah, that's true too. Yeah, that probably had a lot to do with it. But it was about a different concept. That, just like you talked about in the first class, when I speak to you, what I'm actually trying to do is I'm trying to take an idea in my head, and I'm trying to recreate that idea in your head when I'm speaking to you. That's ultimately what I'm trying to do, and I'm hoping that you'll see the thing, because we've all had that experience where we say, I see the thing in my head. I see the idea in my head, and I don't know how to get it out. And you're trying to get it out in a way so that idea then appears in that person's head. And, you know, Hebrew took that very literally in a way to sort of try to speak in a way that painted a picture so that it created the picture in their head. You know, it leaves room for subjectivity and interpretation, which is why over the years, languages have gotten more and more precise to try to be more exact.
Back then, they would sit around the campfire and tell stories.
Right.
That's how things were passed.
Exactly.
It wasn't written, it was told as a story.
Yeah.
We painted a picture.
Exactly. And it was more interesting to listen to when it was, you know, I mean, we've all been, you know, kids, maybe we've been to camp, and there's always that one counselor who sits around the campfire and he's telling some scary story, and he's gonna tell it in a way that's very exciting, and to make it interesting, and so that, you know, to have the language be pictorial like that. Right?
You were talking about sounds, and some of the words when you go into your helps, it'll tell you that a word sounds like such and such instead of being similar to such and such, as it sounds like.
Yeah. It's very much a sensory language about how it sounds and the picture it makes in your head, less than, you know, the technical aspects of Greek, for example.
When we read the Old Testament, New King James say Old Testament,
mm-hmm.
are we reading from Hebrew to English or from Hebrew to Greek to English?
From Hebrew to English.
Hebrew directly to English.
It's a little bit of a process. It's Hebrew, and a lot of scholars use the Septuagint. Remember we talked about what the Septuagint is? It's a Greek translation of the Old Testament. Very helpful because the Old Testament, like I said, was you know, the Hebrew language was very inexact. Intentionally, it's just the nature of how it was. The Greek is very exact, and here were these Hebrew scholars who translated it from Hebrew into Greek, so that we can pick up the exactness and the nuances. Because a lot of the stuff in Hebrew, it's not even that it was so imprecise. It's just that a word can have five different meanings depending on the context of what it's talking about. You know, that's why a lot of the, you know, one of the examples I see a lot is in numbers. That's why you see Pastor Bill say, this is a mistranslation, this is a miswriting or something like that. And you see numbers are different than what they should be, because the word thousand in Hebrew, I think, is like the word, I think it's the word strength. You know, so 10 strengths instead of 10,000. You know, it's something like that. So it's giving you a picture of like the size of it, and it can sometimes be very imprecise. But depending on the context, you can figure out what it's saying. But that's why translating into the Greek, those Hebrew scholars knew the nuances in that context, and they then translated into something that was exact, so we could have exactly. So, for the most part, it's the Hebrew, but a lot of translators will consider the Septuagint to get some of the nuance out of the Hebrew, so they get it right.
So they use both.
They will use both, yeah. But the general reliance is on the original language. But that's what they will use to help them translate from the original language.
And that was King James.
King James, New King James, any reliable source, they're going to use, if they're smart, they're going to use the Septuagint not as a source of the original language, but as a reference. Okay, they're going to look at the Hebrew and say, okay, what does it say in the Hebrew? How do we know it says that? Well, let's look at the Septuagint. That's going to help us to know what the Hebrew is, and then it helps them to translate.
Because these learned ancient Hebrew scholars translated it that way into the Greek.
Right, exactly.
The language, when it says the ancient, the early Semitic, is there a time frame for that?
I wouldn't know. I mean, you know, you're probably talking, it's probably as...
Was it B.C.?
Oh yeah, it's going to be B.C. It's not going to be as far back as, it's probably back to, Moses, maybe a little before Moses. I don't think it's going to go back to Abraham. I don't think Abraham was certainly Semitic, but I don't know that he was speaking Hebrew back then.
I have a statement slash question. So the early form kind of looks like it makes sense, because if you think about some of the cave dwellings or whatever, that they wrote pictures and they drew animals and trees and stuff like that. So that part makes sense. The question I have is, how come we don't read in the Bible, how come we don't have words like Elohim written inside there? How come we don't have El Shaddai? How come we don't have Yahweh inside the actual translation? How come we don't have those words in here?
What do you mean it's not in there?
As far as it translates, you know, YHWH as capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, how come they substitute the actual words for that all of these mean this? Like, I haven't seen El Shaddai actually written in the New King James Version.
Well, you won't see it as El Shaddai. It'll be Lord Almighty, I think it is.
Right, that's my question.
It's just translating it.
But the question actually is how come, because the Elohim is a plural form, but when you just read Lord, you don't read the plural form of Elohim.
Right. Yeah.
So that's kind of what I'm getting at.
Because, you know, you don't want to say lords, because that really gives the wrong impression. But if you say Elohim, again, you know, the idea is to try to get as much into the English as possible. You know, and, you know, Elohim would be God, so you wouldn't say gods. But you want to, you know, even Yahweh, you don't see it. Again, it's not Yahweh. It's a name. It's the word for God. It's the word for Him. You know, the I Am. And when we're translating, the best thing we can do is to try to find something that is the best English equivalent. And the best thing that English scholars came up with was, well, it's Lord. But it's more than Adonai. Adonai means Lord and Master. But this is the Lord, the big Lord, the big Master. So they put it in all caps. And that's, you know, when you see that, when you see L-O-R-D in all caps in the Old Testament, it's the word Yahweh, which is...
Tetragrammaton?
It's Yud, which is, in Tetragrammaton, the four letters, Yud-Heh-Vade, right? Yud-Heh-Vade, close enough.
You can use the W for a V also.
Right.
That's where Jehovah comes from.
Yud-Heh-Vade. It could be a W, it could be Yud-Heh-Vade, you know, it's V's and W's are sort of, and the Y's and the J's can be sort of interchangeable. That's why it went from Yahweh to Yehovah to Jehovah, you know, it's all sort of mixed in.
There's no J in Hebrew. J.
Well, I'm saying in English, when you transliterate it, sometimes people substitute a Y for a J. But it's, again, the attempt is to get it into English. And Adonai and Elohim and Yahweh and Jehovah are not, in the King James, you'll see Jehovah. But in the effort to try to get everything into the English so that it's something that is a word that's familiar to people, that's why you don't see it, you know, other than the names of people or the names of places, you know, which are hard enough. Bob's the only one in our group that can ever read the words, you know, some of the people's names and some of the places. So it's just an attempt to get everything that they can in the English. But that's why it is important to look into the original language to get some of the nuance from it, to see the, you know, that the Yud-Heh-Vad-Heh, you know, and know that there's no way to pronounce that. I mean, it's bad enough that they don't have vowels, but then when you have these four letters together,
you gotta go from right to left.
But But there's just, there's no way to pronounce that. That's the glory of God, that you cannot pronounce his name. And that's why to this day, Jews, when they go to write the word God, they go,
he does that.
You know, or Lord. Right? They won't spell it. They won't say, you know, they don't put it out there. Because it's just part of their culture. Laura?
Yeah, actually, I was going to ring up about the name Elohim, and I didn't know if this was going to be for another lesson, about maybe unpacking the name Elohim just to demonstrate how the characters are put together to form that concept, that idea.
Yeah, I mean, that's something, it's not something that we'll go through in this class, but it's something you should look into. I mean, all the aspects of it, just the construction of Elohim, and also just some of the stuff that we've heard Pastor Bill talk about how it is a, you know, it is a plural, it's a singular, it's a plural, but it is a unified plural, and that it is a plural that stands for three or more. That El is one, Eloi is two, and Elohim is three or more. Yeah, you know, so we see the...
Where's the heme part in there?
Heme is plural. It's just things in the plural in Hebrew and in M, like cherub is an angel, cherubim are plural. A seraph is another kind of angel, seraphim are plural. So we put an S, they put an M, basically.
Very important, which a lot of people don't realize, that in Hebrew, a word like Elohim is plural, but it's always followed by a singular verb, whereas in Hebrew,
right.
You always have a plural verb with a plural noun. And that's the only time when they use a plural with a singular verb, which goes along with three being one.
Three being one, yeah.
And then rabbis, they call that God's majesty.
Yeah, and
like
even
that.
In the Shema, that our you know, the Lord our God, Elohim, is one, Echad, which Echad is one. The closest example would be like if I say, look, we're all one here. It's a unity of many. It's a oneness of several. So when they say the Lord our God is one, Echad, it doesn't mean one singular. It means a unity of several. So that's the beauty of it, is that you see the Trinity even in the Old Testament. So... all right, quickly, we are going to go through Ephesians 2 as quickly as we can here. Let's do this. I mean, if any of you guys have done some work, we'll go over it. But let's just start going through. Let's underline some words that we want to see what it says in the original Greek. Okay? Shout out a word.
Grace.
Grace, yeah.
Save.
What else?
Gift.
Gift.
God.
Before him.
Alive. Ephesians 2, 8 to 10, alive.
Him down.
That's it.
Him down.
Works.
And we've got works.
Right in front of him.
We've got works here, and we've got works here.
Can you hit have been along with saved?
Not a work.
Can I do what?
Hit have been along with saved.
That's pretty much it. Not yourself is important.
Grace. And we got grace, yeah.
Boast.
What's that?
Boast.
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 What do we say, spirit? Anybody else? Anything else?
Faith.
Faith, I got.
Workmanship.
Created.
Prepared.
Boast. What? What was it? Somebody just said?
Boast.
Yeah, I got boast.
Works.
God. Works I got. I think God I got.
We have beforehand.
Beforehand. I think the only two I'm going to add, I think we got just about everything that I think we're going to have up there. The only two I'm going to add is, believe it or not, here we go. Rock the prepositions of the small words.
Four.
Okay. Now, just for the sake of time, some of these are pretty straightforward. God in the Greek is theos, just means God. Very simply, it just means God. So there's not a lot to dig into there. The same thing with Christ Jesus, Christos, which just means the anointed one. Christ Jesus, and Jesus is just a name in the Greek. And they say it's just a name, but unfortunately, you know, his name was not, it was not some rare, unusual name. In the Hebrew, it was Yahshua, which is Joshua. Anybody here named Joshua? Usually you can't have a room with too many people without having somebody named Josh. Basically the same name. So it was a fairly common name. Like you see, Yehuda was another common Hebrew name, and James. James is Jacob. Those were a lot of common names.
It should actually be the book of Yaakov. Not James.
Yeah, right, Yaakov. Right.
They honored King James, and he was also anti-Semitic. So they
took it out.
Book of James.
Now, in reality, when you say Christ Jesus, you can take it out.
I don't mean take it out. I just mean it's straightforward to what it means.
Here, in Christ Jesus, there's a lot of times
but there's
a specific here. Like, for me, when I looked at it, I looked at, instead of grace, I looked at by grace.
Okay.
And I had by grace, I had through faith, and I put not from yourselves as one. I think you did the same thing. And in Christ, in that section where it says Christ Jesus.
And you're right. This is a tremendous theological principle to look at.
Right.
I'm just saying, from the point of view of the original language, it's pretty straightforward. There's no other way to translate other than in Christ Jesus. There's volumes of meaning behind it. But remember, we're not going for meaning. We're just going for what it says.
Okay.
And we're going to get to what it means. We're going to do this verse. We're going to do all our steps, and we're going to get to all the meaning. We're going to stir this stuff up. But today, we're just looking at what these words actually say in the original language. And just to, I said four because four, it's a small word, God. A causative particle standing always after one or more words in a clause and expressing the reason for what has been said before, affirmed or implied. Four in the sense of because and so forth. So when we look at it, again, not trying to add too much meaning to it, but assuming I can find it. What is it saying just before that? It says that in the ages to come, he's talking about being raised together, sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved. So this verse is referring back to God being glorified. Very important to think about that. Again, I'm not going to try to attach any meaning to it yet, but just know that this verse is referring back to a verse that is talking about God being glorified, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us. That everything that he's done here, it's important that we understand it's for his glory. Because, in other words, God is going to be glorified because it's by grace you were saved, not of you. You're not getting glorified. He's getting glorified. Because this four is referring back to the previous verse. Scott?
Yeah, just like, you know, I've heard many years ago, anytime you see the word therefore,
that's right.
Read before.
You look and see what it's there for.
Pointing back up to it.
Okay, so next word, grace. Many of us are probably familiar with this word, charis. Comes from a word, kairos, means to rejoice. It's sort of, again, this because it's Easter, there's sort of an emotional aspect to it. When you receive a gift, a free gift, for no reason, right? Didn't earn it, it's a surprise. Here, I'm giving you a gift for what? Nothing, because I just want to give you a gift. There's a sense of rejoicing and excitement and gratification. It's a favor, an acceptance. Okay? There's a favor done without expectation of return. Absolutely free expression of loving kindness of God to men, finding its only motive in the bounty and benevolence of the giver. A little bit of a commentary in here. Unmerited favor is one of the things. It is something that is given to you that you do not earn.
I thought you mentioned last week that it was the same word as gift, but I guess we're going
to... You know what? I have to correct myself. It is not the same word as gift. It does mean a gift. It does, but in this verse, there's a different word for gift, and we'll get to that in a minute. But you're right. And by is actually not in the original language. It's just that the word grace is in what's called the dative case. The dative case is the case of the indirect object. So it's saying that we are saved. It's saying, so we sort of jump ahead, for you have been saved by grace. If we want to restructure the language to make it sound a little, you know, it's the by is not in there. It's just the grace is in a particular case that says that it was the instrument by which this thing happened. It was called a dative of instrumentation. When the word is in that case, it means that it is the instrument of it. Okay, this is where we're going to get, and I'm going to do my best, because this is, Tony and I have been bantering this back and forth. This is one of the most unusual constructions that I have ever seen. Okay? It actually says, if you have a King James, who has a King James in front of them right now and has the verse in front of them? What does it say? Does it say have been? For by grace
are you saved.
There we go. Different. For by grace you are saved. So wait a minute. Pastor Rick, that sounds like two different types of verbs. Have been and are. Well, guess what? They're both in there. Because it actually says, by grace you are, have been saved. Saved is a perfect passive participle. So we would put saved in the perfect tense. Okay? You have, but not you have saved, it's passive. So you have been saved, okay? And it's a participle, so it's describing your current condition. But yet the word to be, eimi, in the Greek, is in here, actually. The King James put that in and took this out. The New King James took that out and put this in, because if you put the two together, it makes no sense in English. You are have been saved. You know?
Right. So my question is, in the King James we have italicized words, and it doesn't that mean that they're put in, that it's not there?
Well, it can mean that they're there, that they're not in the original language, but they're there for clarification. Right. Why? Is it something italicized?
Not in that case.
No. If you see that in the King James, or the New King James, if you see a word as italicized, it doesn't necessarily, I know Pastor Bill sometimes says, cross it out, and sometimes it's fine to cross it out, because sometimes it's superfluous. It doesn't need to be in there. But sometimes it's just there to help it read better. So when you see a word in italicized, it doesn't mean it's evil, it shouldn't be in there. It just means sometimes the writers, the translators, put it in there to make it a little easier to flow. Because if they had put, you are have been saved, we would have said, this guy doesn't know how to speak English. Okay, but that's what's in the original language, you know. So we can, and I'll tell you what, I'm just going to leave it there, because we're just looking at what it says. and we'll talk next week maybe, you start thinking about what you think that means. You are, have been saved. Right? Start thinking of it as your homework. Just that one phrase, you are, have been saved. Think about what that means. You know, look up perfect passive participle. This are is a present active indicative. Very simple word. It's in the present. Currently, you know, the current time, it is active, so it's doing the action. You're the one doing it somehow. And it's indicative, which means it's just stating it for a fact. Okay?
I think you just said it. I think it's very understandable. We have been and we are at the moment. It never changes.
That's my way to look at it, but because I'll tell you what, Tony and I have been like wrestling a bit. There's so many ways to look at this, but just think about it. We're not going to talk about it tonight. We're going to move on. But when we get back next week, we're going to start talking about meaning, and I want us to do a little bit of exercising and look at that phrase and see if we think we know what it means. What is it actually trying to say?
The grace of God is the expression of His goodness.
Right. Yep, that's it. Free expression of His goodness with no contemplation of reward. Alright. Through this, the word dia is the word that's used here. And this is another one that is sort of an instrument. The instrument or intermediate cause of that which intervenes. Okay? So it is the, there's a lot of verbiage in there, but It is the instrument or the cause of this. So it is through faith. Faith, pistis, okay? Persuasion, creeds, a moral conviction, religious truth. There is a reliance upon it. It is more than just a belief. It's more than just, well, I think this is true, or I believe this is true. It is putting your trust in something, okay? It is more than just a credo. It is, you know, when the example I like to use is, I can believe that this chair exists. That's one form of belief. But this is another form of belief. When I put my trust in it, when I rest upon it, when I rely upon it, you know, and I can tell you, as you can I guess if I look at me, I've taken some chairs out. I put a beat down in some chairs, especially those hollow aluminum ones in the summer, you know, you sit on and they don't like me at all, you know. So I look at chairs, like those chairs that you guys are in, that Brian's in over there, I don't sit on those chairs. I don't trust those chairs because there's no back to them. And I think that if I sit on that thing's just going to snap like a twig. So I don't sit in those chairs. I do not pistuo them. You know, but these ones, even as creepy as these ones look, I'll sit in these because they're pretty sturdy.
Sorry, I don't want to stray off into apologetics, yeah. But usually when you use a chair example, it's not belief at all to look at it, and I say believe in it. You have to sit in it.
Right, well, belief, it just means believe that something exists. That's all I mean. I believe, I make mental assent that it exists.
Okay.
But to put my faith in it.
That's distinguished from faith.
Right. Okay, and this is a point. This is a good point. Not of yourselves. This word humon means concerning you. Okay, belong. It's in the genitive case. The genitive case is the case of possession. Okay, so when I say, you know, that's my Bible. That Bible, that's Rick's Bible. So that Bible would be in the genitive case. Okay, this is not our possession. This is not of yourselves. This is in yourself is in the genitive case, meaning this salvation is not our possession. It's His. It remains His. Right? It is the gift. Doron, different word. Again, I apologize for last week saying that. I thought it was the same word. Which means a present, a gift, a sacrifice. Okay? Interesting that it has both connotation of a present, something you would present to God, but here it is the gift of God. It's something that God is sacrificing, in a sense, putting on the altar for us. We always think of putting things on the altar for God, but He put His Son on the altar for us, right? Works, ergon. This will apply, it's the same word in both places, okay? performance, the result or object of employment, making or working, labor, business, employment. You know, it's generally to work, to do a deed. Okay, so it's nothing that we have done. It's nothing that we have, it's like a production. Nothing that we have produced. Okay, so that, lest anyone, I'm sorry, I missed that, lest anyone is, two words, hina me. Okay, expression consisting of hina, which means in order that, and me, which means not. So it's in order not. Okay, in order not that anyone should boast. And the word boast. Kakaomai. And this says that some Greek lexicons deduce it from the word auken, which means the neck, which vain persons are apt to carry in a proud manner. So think of, and this is, we'll see this a lot in Greek, that certain words, like the word worship, proskuneo, means to kiss toward. All right? And it comes from another word that means to lie flat on your face. Okay, so you'll see some of these pictures in some of these words. And here's one that the word boast means, it comes from a word that means neck. And think about what, you know, if you're showing somebody your neck, you're it's a proud stance, isn't it? That you can, it's mine. Okay, we are. I think we didn't get that one. But we are, and this is important, just to see, okay, it's just a present, active, indicative, simple. But even when it's simple, understand that when something is in the present active, indicative, it means it talks about a current state. And think about that when we're talking about we are his workmanship. And we'll get to workmanship in a second, but we are. It's a current state that we are in, that we are his workmanship. And I love this word, workmanship, poema. We get the word poem from it. Another synonym, who's some musicians? Any musicians in the room? Okay. You know what an opus is? Anybody know what an opus is? It's like the work of your life, right? An opus is the thing that you have produced, that you, it's something that you display and say, this is my work, this is the body of my work, right? And that's what he's saying. We are his workmanship. We are his opus. We are his poema. Something may, our work, our, he is, we are his work product. Okay?
Praise God.
Right, yeah. Created. Ktidzo. Proprietorship. That's interesting, isn't it? See, that's the kind of thing you don't necessarily, you think of create, okay, made something out of nothing. And that's what it means, to fabricate. Okay, to found, to create something. But through the idea of proprietorship, in other words, I'm making it and it's mine. Okay, I'm the proprietor of this thing that I am creating. Okay, created in Christ Jesus, we talked about that. For good works, we talked about works, that's ergon, same thing. And prepared beforehand, that's another one. Unto. For good works. This is in the, I think in the New King, in the King James, it says unto. Epi, that's that word epi, upon. Okay? To rest upon, in the motion upon, toward. So toward good works, for sort of for the purpose of, that is, not that we are relying upon the good works, but the good works are there for us, for our salvation. Not that the works produce our salvation, but our salvation produces the works. But I'm not getting the meaning more. But, okay, good works. good, benevolent, profitable. Sometimes just certain words can pop out. You think about profitable works. Think of what profitable means. Good for something. Not just good in sort of this, theological or philosophical sense, but profitable, useful, important works, that God didn't just do us to be good people, but he saved us to do something important. Okay? And then ergon, same word as before, ergon. Okay, prepared beforehand. Here's one of those compound words. Pro ectoimazo. Pro means, see, from pro, which means before, and ectoimazo, which means to make ready. So to make ready beforehand. Okay? So that God, and that's what prepared, and it's just one word, prepared beforehand. We have it as two words in the English, but in the Greek it's just one, it's just that one word. Proetoimazo, which means to get ready, that one word means to get ready beforehand. Okay? God had them ready, these, you know, the good works that he has, even the works that we do are still his. He had prepared them for us, right? He had them ready for us beforehand that we should walk. This is another one of my favorite words. I like the word walk in the Greek, it's peripateo, which means to literally means to like tread about. Okay? So it almost always speaks of behavior. Okay? Generally to walk, figure to live or pass one's life. That's the conduct of our life. Okay? So, I kind of went through it quick, but that's just a quick exercise of what we can do. And this is what you do when you're doing a word study. Just underline some words. Now this verse has got a ton of words. Some won't have that many, but this verse has got a ton of words. But you know, don't miss certain words like for and through, you know, and unto. Just for the heck of it, look those kinds of things up. Again, we live in an age now where it can take seconds to look up a word and just see if there's anything there. Sometimes you look at it, it means what it means. And you go, okay, you know, in means in. That's what it is. There's nothing all that amazing about it. But again, like Larry was saying, you put it with in Christ Jesus, and well, now what does that mean? You know, and that could take on a whole new meaning. But it is. This is sort of the exercise you want to go through. Look at the words that stand out to you. Write them down, and then look them up. There's a Bible out there called the Keyword Study Bible, and it does just this. It underlines what it calls keywords, and one of the neat things it does is it underlines a word, and then it'll give you a little Strong's number right above it. And you can look either in the back of that Bible or you get your Strong Concordance out and look that word up and find out what that word is. And Strong's has cataloged every word in the Bible. And by every word, I mean every single word in the King James Bible. That's why it's called the Exhaustive Concordance. You know, they've got one section for all the words like the, and it, and you know, it's got a whole section just so you can see where the verses are. But it has, but they're there. And that numbering system, that cataloging numbering system has become the universal numbering system for biblical Greek words. So just about any lexicon or word study book you're going to look at is going to have a Strong's number attached to it. So that you'll know that that's what the word is, and you can look it up in all kind of like the keyword. Here's the keyword study Bible. One of the things that I have that I'll show you guys is there is a word study reference. It's a two-volume set. One is word study of the Old Testament. One is word study of the New Testament. That is takes that Bible. It takes the back, that little, you know, sort of the back half back. Third or back quarter of that Bible is all the original word, you know, the original language words. But takes those things and makes them this big and just expands on all those definitions. And it's by a man named Spiros Zodiadis, who is a a Greek scholar. So it's another tool that I'll show you guys. It's kind of a cumbersome one, but I downloaded it on my eSword, so I that's where I get a lot of these. So it's sort of these extended definitions is from him. But this is how you just get down to just finding out what some of these words are and what they say. And then from that, now next week we're going to come back and we're going to take some of the stuff that what it says and start attaching some meaning to it, start pulling some things out of it. So first assignment I gave you guys was just think about that. Think about that phrase. But also just spend some time. I want you to spend some time meditating on this verse. Okay, hopefully we've all read it 30 times. We were supposed to read it, right? Begin to read it again slowly, quietly. Meditate on it. Ask God to show you some things in it. And then next week when we start digging into the meaning and trying to attach some significance to some of these words and some of these phrases and what we think it means, then at least we'll have prepared hearts and we'll be thinking about some of this stuff. So that's the homework for this week. Any questions? Wow, quick this week. Not quick by the clock, but
quick again. A quick question.
Sure.
Who came up with the idea, like when we refer to God, when we put a capital H for he or a capital H for him?
It's not in the original.
Yeah.
The original is very capitalization in the Greek, anyway. I'm not sure about Hebrew. Is there even uppercase and lowercase?
No, there's no upper or lower.
There's no upper or lowercase in Hebrew. In Greek, there is an upper or lowercase. I think you'll see it on your thing now. Very few things are uppercase in Greek. First names are just about the only thing that are in uppercase in Greek. So it's just something that the translators decided to put to help people see that it's referring to Jesus or God in the context of
King James. Do that?
I think the King James does. I don't really, because it's one of those things I really pay very little attention to, because I never know. Yeah, it's just not, and that's the thing, and that's why, because it's not anything that's original. It's a man-made thing, so. We don't really have to pay too much attention to it. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you again. Thank you for the majesty and the gift of language that you have given us, and help us to just muddle through some of this stuff and understand the meanings that are packaged away in these words. And this week, Father, help us to really hear your voice as we meditate on this verse. And glean from it what you would have us to glean from it. And just bless us now as we go, and keep us in Jesus' name we pray.